first ever women to perform in a gold medal match at the World Championships is here in the bronze medal match, and she scores a monster goal for Canada.
She averages 0.3 goals in the competition, and she picks up a goal in this one. 2 points the difference at the end of the third. Canada will come out and put pressure on Japan, and if they slip up early on, it's anyone's game.
Officially the score, it is Japan 40, Canada 38 at three-quarter time. And this is a reflection across the game so far.
Oh, look down at the bottom, penalties. 9 for Canada, just the 4 for Japan. I said Canada's discipline needed to improve. Well, they haven't turned over the ball as much in the game in that third quarter. Still 6 for the game. And that man, Madell, played the last few seconds absolutely perfectly to bring his team back within 2. And to try and answer Ikezaki, Shimakawa, and of course, Yukinobu, IKE as well. And there is IKE, the number 21. Those three options for Japan have yielded the most points. But Madell has yielded 1 or 2 himself.
It's a capacity crowd in Rio. These Paralympic Games have been an overwhelming success, and the wheelchair rugby competition is coming into its final day. Equally are these Paralympic Games, and it has been a tremendous wheelchair rugby tournament. Number 3 against number 4 in the world are contesting for bronze. It is Japan with the lead by 2, Canada with the inbound to start this 4th and what could potentially be the final period of action. It is the top gun for Canada, Madell, to take the opening possession. And they're going to count that forward. So interestingly there, he actually, I think, loses the ball. Well, just from our vantage point, seeing it, they count it as a goal on our system officially, yet to see on the graphic. But we'll just look for clarity on the official play-by-play system. He's kind of confused. They're going to call it a timeout. So we'll watch it again from a better angle. And it goes off the chair of EK at the end. And we saw a difficult call for the Canadians against the Australians earlier in the tournament, where actually Zak Madell was being chased by Riley Batt. And he did a good enough job to get the ball back off the chair of Riley Batt before he left the field of play. And the referees don't get the benefit of replay. They assessed it as last touch by the Canadians. They were very sharp on that one because it did go off the wheel of IKE last before leaving the field.
It's a good show, defense by IKE though. He showed the line to Madell as Whitehead goes over.
And it's a quick strike. So they utilize this opening possession in the 4th period and they have cut it to 1. And things are getting interesting indeed.
This is a huge play because if Canada can stop the Japanese here, they've got the possession. I don't think they're going to, though. Bilecki would do well. She can't quite get that.
It's Ikezaki who scores again for the Japanese. And he has the lion's share. Well, actually, he and IKE share it almost equally. The two of them working together. He's got himself a baker's dozen with 13, does Ikezaki. 15 for his running mate, as it's Whitehead. Will go over the top. That's a dangerous play. He's forced the issue there. And how quick the pass back, so precisely given. That is a sense that these two athletes for Japan have for one another. That's a moment to remember.
The balance of IKE there was superb. He really, you could see that he'd played basketball before. He reached across, grabbed the ball, sent it straight back. What a play from IKE. And Japan can go 3 ahead once more.
And Ikezaki across the line, he slams it down with authority as well. He suggests he didn't mean to overcook it, ref. Unsportsmanlike call against, but he feels good about that one. They reestablished what is a three-goal lead now in that sequence, and that could be a blemish that might just be too much to overcome for Canada. They've got a 3-on-1 here, and Whitehead will get to 40 goals.
EK had no option there at all. Whoever he went to, the other player was almost certainly going to score. In the end, he just had to let it happen.
The Canadians are back. Hirschfield thrashes out his left hand, then tries to pick his pocket. Whitehead is big enough and heavy enough to prevent Ikezaki's entrance on this side. Ike will have to go around the end, but Hirschfield has ushered him the other direction, and they are equally able to find it. Whichever way you want to slice it, they can dice it. The Japanese will score a 43rd. Whitehead taking a little bit of a bumpy road to try to get this ball across the center line. It'll be Madell who is forced, first of all, by Ike and Norimatsu, but he comes out of that little bit of a fray. He scores again, and he's got 29 goals for himself of these 41 now for the North Americans.
Here's an amazing performance from Madell. Three defensive fouls, couple of turnovers.
It's gone long out for Ike, but he's in good enough position. He holds his line. You see that he is a little bit top heavy. He's got the impairment in his lower limbs as well, but he recovers his balance. He's so extensive to reach for the ball. We've seen that in the last few passages of play. But Madell right back again. And even though they've given up that chance, that pass intended from Whitehead to Madell that turned the score over, he's on 30. It's still enough time for a mistake to be made by the Japanese. They're going to need to, though, Canada, find a little bit more pressure against from here. Inside to Norimatsu, and he's wide open. Biletsky isn't going to be able to recover in time. And for him, that's another new score for Japan. They have six different scores in this match.
Great team goal there, though, because although Ike didn't get the goal, he went up, he helped out Ikezaki. Whitehead there goes over for the Canadians.
And you see what it means to the world's media in attention here courtside. All of the Japanese cameras looking to capture a moment where they claim bronze, their first ever medal potentially awaiting for Japan in the wheelchair rugby. It's Norimatsu again. He now has a pair for the Asian side.
Two in very quick succession for Norimatsu. He's averaging averaging 2.8 goals per game for the competition so far. Lovely turn from Madell. Super pace. He's got Hirschfield with him.
And it's that crazy eight movement from Zach Madell as he winds and twists and turns, and he doesn't need a lot of space in which to create an opening. He again across the line. And what he needs now more than anything, he's got Whitehead coming in, putting pressure on. This is good play, but Madell cannot get to Ikezaki in time, and you want to catch him early. But he'll throw on the brakes and settle things down for Japan. The Canadians much more forceful now. But it's hurrying up to wait right now as he waits for his opportunity, and patience pays off for Ikezaki. A lane, he exploits it, and to 47, Japan will travel.
I was surprised there, the Canadians split their defense. Biletsky was actually up with the other three and they were quite high. She dropped off back towards the goal line and it opened up the opportunity for Ike to take advantage, and you saw him go and hit Biletsky, and the Japanese got the goal.
In again, good position for Madell. You see how he dominates the scoreline for Canada. And it always brings that question when you see the equal distribution between the two Japanese players. Whether or not you, of course, aren't stronger with that balance in your lineup, it's proving a slight margin right now for Japan. This is Ikezaki, who with a couple different moves has had to slow it down. He goes back out to his number two, and these two players interchangeable as to who really is the dominant force. inside, right back in the tall number 21, takes it again. Their captain for Japan. They have a 3-goal lead.
Fans are absolutely loving this. He's not. He's looking rather stressed at the moment. Canada going to miss a medal for the first time since Sydney. 5 Paralympic Games, that is. 5 Paralympic Games, 4 in a row.
And the timeout has been called here by Japan. And officially, they've come across. It's 60 seconds that they will utilize now. And Orr has gone across to the scorer's bench to indicate his substitutions. Ikezaki is getting buckled in for the storm about to come of 3:29 in this fourth period.
Well, the Canadians in the stands look quite calm and relaxed and like they're having fun. I'm not sure the Canadians on court or just on the sideline on the Canadian bench will be quite so jovial, really. Very, very tense, this one.
It is the top gun for Canada, and uncontested, they will let him go through. You sometimes wonder whether or not that is a game plan, because as long as Madell is scoring, he isn't generating the other options on his side to be activated, who are going to have to play a part in changing the scoreline.
Yeah, it surprised me that the Japanese defense, two of them just sat on the left-hand side of the goal line, made no effort to get to Madell, as you say, and obviously just accepting that that's how it's going to be, but they're going to stay ahead. And they could go further ahead here if Ike can get through. He can't. Great defense that time by Madell.
Around the backside, Ikezaki is able to navigate and negotiate his way for a 17th goal for Japan. And again, they reestablished that 3-goal margin.
We said great defense by Madell, and it was, but it was Ike was keeping him entertained, and that opened up the gap. The pace wasn't then there from the Canadian defense.
And Madell again with another score. But is it another score that will be good enough in a match here against this Japanese side, who have just altered their tactics and equally having a peak performance from their top two players? Again, the passing sequence is perfectly delivered. And it's Ike who scores an 18th. As they just are back and forth, these two scores, they turn it over, and Japan are really putting the pressure. They're turning the screw on the Canadians here. Madell getting frustrated, and he just, direct line comes across to lay into Ike, but they will now start to play this game management role. They do it so well. Down low to Norimatsu, but he gets away from him. So a little bit of a let off for the Canadians.
Yeah, Norimatsu has a couple of goals in the bronze medal game so far, but just the slip from Ikezaki, too far away from Norimatsu, and as soon as it left Ikezaki's hand, you thought this could be a difficult finish for the Japanese. What they've done really well today, though, they've had more options than the Canadians, and now, when the pressure's telling, they're the ones that are working the game better. They're managing, as you say, the game better. That man is obviously saying the right words on the bench.
He's kept pretty calm throughout this tournament, and they all know coming into it with these top 8 teams in the world where likely the tournament's going to be won and lost, where they expect to be able to finish. And both of these teams would of course love to have been in the gold medal match, but as it goes on and they take on the top teams in this tournament, they probably all know inside where they have performed at.
You have to, looking at the game, you have to feel that Kevin Orr is an option short for Canada. They haven't, the Japanese have another option to come on apart from their two main players. Canada, they've got this man, 35 points now. But then you look through it, Michael Whitehead's got 5. Another player's 1 and 2. There's not enough other options for them.
It's Norimatsu into Ike. Caldwell comes across to be the first threat to put pressure. But Ikezaki, again with that signature and distinctive style. He's got speed, he's got power, he's got equally some flair, and you see him indicating to his bench, listen, I got this one, boys. We're across the line, and that's his 18th goal.
Yeah, Cody Caldwell couldn't get across enough to stop him. Zakawa, well, He sighs once more, but for different reasons, I think, this time. It's almost the disbelief of what they could well be about to do as Adele just gets some mechanical assistance on his chair.
136 remains in this bronze medal match in the fourth period. There could be more if something miraculous happens from here. But at this distance, Japan have proven themselves in this sport to be on a upward trend. And this might be their moment where they finally break into the podium hopes. It's going to be Caldwell who picks up the leftovers there. He puts it on the shelf and calls a timeout with 127 for Canada.
Well, the Canadians need some magic here. They need some creativity. The man you have to look to is Madell. It's been absolutely unbelievable for them today. But Japan, no doubt, will keep that defensive line tight and make it as difficult as they can. All they need to do is stay one ahead. They can afford potentially one slip-up, really. Only 1 minute 27 left to go. They won't want to slip-up, obviously. They will want to stretch ahead further. As we see the number 15, Patrice Simard. He's got himself on the scoreboard today with a couple, averaging 4.3 goals per game.
No Whitehead out there as Madell will just ram into Kishi and he will get credit for the 49th goal, or Canada will. Officially, it'll be seen as a team goal, that one. It's irrelevant from here. Canada have it within two, but Whitehead is on the sideline. It's Simard out there with Hirschfield and Caldwell. A changing of the guard a little bit for Canada with this distribution of floor time. It's into Ike. They've got an anchor on him. They are making life difficult over to Ikezaki. And at the center line, if they could force an over and back, but it's Ike. He does the quick spin move, and he's brought about Madell and a foul on the play.
You felt that Hirschfield really over pushed the defense against EK, which brought Madell in, and Madell was forced to make the foul. But good defense from the Canadians because they kept Japan in their backcourt for much longer than they have in this game so far.
It's Madell calling for some technical support. He needs an adjustment, but it's all about Japan from here. As again, Ikezaki is just toweling off the sweat and perspiration from what has been his best game of the tournament. Might not have been his overall goals. He averages in a match 22 per game. He has 18 right now, but he has been pretty much perfect today for Japan. On both sides of the ball, as Madell will get his tires changed. And he will sit down for what will be less than a minute in that penalty box waiting.
How long can Japan keep him out of the game?
It is a trade-off from this distance, whether or not you want the goal or whether or not you want to take the time. They should be able to. Japan squeeze the life out of this Canadian hope right now on the floor. It's Biletsky, it's Hirschfield, and now Whitehead out there as the three players. But they are just moving in time and seeing what could have been a medal hope start to evaporate right in front of their eyes. It is, in fact, a timeout called by Japan, and it will leave Madell still watching, and he's going to have to probably watch this one for the remaining 21.1. as they will get 15 more seconds. We'll see officially what they have on the actual scoring clock, but Japan are putting on a real well-crafted finish to this match.
Well, it's a bit of a taste of his own medicine for Madell. He did this to the Japanese earlier in the game, and now they're just saying, well, you can now sit and watch whilst we wrap up the bronze. A historic day for Japanese wheelchair rugby. A fantastic day for them, and you have to say they've deserved it.
They have been strong. They have been the cleaner of the two sides as far as overall ball maintenance. You see they've got just 10 seconds officially on their scoring clock. They'll be glad to score it. Out comes Madell. He'll get a chance now with just over 13 seconds to be involved in it. But it is really just details, as this will go up and it will, in fact, be last touched by the Japanese. And Canada will utilize a substitution. In comes Willsie, the veteran of his side, as well for Chan. They get some late duty in this one at the end of these games in Rio. And there, a moment for them equally to remember in their Paralympic careers. But it's Whitehead who will take the receipt of the ball. He'll score, take it to a half century for Canada. But with 3.9, Japan are about to take a bronze medal. Their first ever in a Paralympic Games competition, and things slow down a little bit. They'll have to wait.
The Japanese fans are bouncing. What a day for them.
And it's contact on the arm. And the expression on Kevin Orr's face, it says it all. I think he is equally on the cusp of emotion there too. And every story a different one that gets to these moments as they are totally synchronized on that Japanese bench awaiting respectfully for another 0.7 of a second to expire.
As Norimatsu was waiting to inbound the ball there, he nearly had his wheel changed, but didn't need it. They ran over to him and he said, no, it's not me that needs the new wheel. What an achievement for these guys. What an achievement for the coach. Koichi Ogino. Although you wouldn't know it at the moment, the bench is completely stony-faced. They haven't won it yet.
It's the inbound and it's the Ikezaki, and in doing so, Japan in the wheelchair rugby are going to take their first ever medal at the Paralympic Games. It's going to be a bronze against the reigning silver medalist from London, and it's a moment in history for this sport as it grows and the dominance starts to spread around the globe. You see what it means to Ikezaki. He had his best team game of the performance, and he with his running mate Ike, they get it done when it matters most. It'll be the bronze medal to Japan, 52-50 over Canada. And Canada have medaled in this competition every single time except for against, well, it was in Sydney that they did. And the emotion, what a moment in time for both these teams for different reasons. It's elation for Japan and despair for the Canadians. Watch it unfold.
Well, Japanese rugby really is on fire at the moment. 2015 was a magic year for Japanese rugby union. 2016, a magic year for wheelchair rugby. This is such emotional times for the Japanese. The Canadians will be feeling emotional, but for different reasons. Japan have snatched the bronze, their first ever medal. You've got to feel sorry for the likes of Biletsky. The 27-year-old, the only female player on the court. She won't go away from Rio with a medal. The Canadians leave the Paralympic Games for the first time since Sydney with nothing around their necks.
And we have seen it in these lines where they have shaken hands at the end of the match. The respect and also the regard for the dominant nations in this tournament. The Japanese were the better team today, and they could hardly wait for the expiry of 32 minutes. It has been a journey. They finished fourth in London 4 years ago. They will finish one better in Rio, and a medal for the first time ever in this competition. And the first thing that the Canadians do, it's an acknowledgement of a cheer for Japan. And that is the spirit of this Paralympic Games, and equally in this sport. They have
the level of respect.
It is. It is entirely that, as the respect for their own fans and family that have been here, and these Brazilians who have come out to support it. Zak Madel, who always seems to take things a little bit with a grain of salt. He will put this into perspective, and he'll know as a leader that they need to find an answer in which to get back onto the medal podium. As although he carried the load individually for Canada, he will want to, of course, become a winner again. And you will see a bright future. He'll be back.
we can all see how talented he is, but what he will also know as well in the back of his mind, with plenty more time in his career to go and win medals, is he just needs that extra bit of support. They need to find those other options, which Japan had, the likes of Ike there in the number 21 shirt. Japan taking home the medal and the match ball.
Shimakawa, of course, a part of the side back to 2004 when they first start participating at these Paralympic Games in wheelchair rugby. A moment for him as he looks on. And we look in, a sacred moment where they consolidate what has been their last four-year journey.
Statistics. Goal average 21.4, turnover average just 1.8, emotion etched on his face, and who can blame him? The Japanese have just, they just took the game by the scruff of the neck as well. In the important moments of the games, they had more players who were capable of doing the right things. And you see the leading scorers there.
Remember, the Japanese in that last matchup against the Americans, who are already in the gold medal match, they will take on Australia. They had an extra time defeat against the Americans, and it looked as though they had done enough themselves, even in regulation. The Americans found a way to win that one, but there the story of the stats in this one. 7 steals, no steals for the Canadians in this matchup. It's the bronze to Japan. The first ever medal goes to the Asians in wheelchair rugby in this